young students, and particularly since I have known Mr. Singh for a very long time, coming here, it's a pleasure to interact with you. It was actually just a background that I did law, and Mr. Singh was a principal in that GSE college. So that brings back more memories. As a practitioner of law, not law but actually enforcing law, I have a perspective about cyber law as well as other legal enactments, and I will try to base my this lecture more on what are the practical issues which are involved in the cyber law, and also give you some basics, because I'm told there are first year as well as like mostly 3 year and 5 year courses. So let me see how this goes. You can ask me in case there is something that you don't understand, and I'll be very happy to respond. Okay. So we'll talk about what the background is, how the cyber law came to being, what are the various provisions, some amendments. Actually, the IT law came into being in the year 2000, and it was amended in the year 2008. So we'll talk about them, and some basic pointers as to what are the things which need to be done, still need to be done, which are still missing, and how the courts are appreciating the various enactments, how the courts are interpreting them. That also I'll try to touch base on. So that's where we will take this. So this is just the basic history, formed in the year 2000. And then basically this was through United Nations Commission on International Trade and Law, which wanted that every country who is a member of United Nations should have a model cyber law. And basically because trade and law, you see, UNICITRAL is United Nations Commission on International Trade and Law. So when you do trade, they wanted that everything could not have been done through postal or through sending by snail mails. So as the technology progressed, they wanted that there should be some recognition for electronic commerce. That means that whatever emails you send should be recognized, and that should be taken as an evidence in the court. Earlier it was not there, and since most countries were not implementing it, the United Nations wanted that every country should implement this, so that there's some reciprocity. Reciprocity meaning that if I send a mail to your country and you respond or whatever, that should be taken as an evidence in a court in case of any dispute or any arbitration if that happens. So that's what it was. It focuses on digital signatures, and there are lacunas, some of it in here, which doesn't, data privacy. You must be hearing about the huge Facebook case recently. I will touch upon that some bit to tell you as to what exactly it means. And number of high profile cases, I think you must have heard about the freedom of expression case of under 66A, which is of where it was said, the government said that you cannot write anything which is derogatory in a blog or in any kind of Facebook post. Which was held actually against. I mean, the court said, look, there is a freedom of expression here, and up to a limited extent, up to those exceptions which are there in the Article 19, you will be allowed to write anything, and the police cannot really take action. And that's the case of that Palghar girls who had written something about at that time against Shiv Sena leaders. So that has been now settled, and you could, but then there are those exceptions which are basically sovereignty of the nations, friendly relations. Those are six or seven exceptions which are under Article 19. Defamation is also one which is actually being seriously debated, that whether the defamation should be, does it infringe on your freedom of expression. And that's a battle in the courts at the moment. So we will see what happens to Section 500 of the IPC. So that's the background. Let's see. So the real, let me tell you this, in the year 2000 when this was formed, when the IT Act was formed, Mr. Mahajan was a minister of IT. And that time United Nations was forcing India. Internet had come into being somewhere in 1995 in a major sense, that email started happening in 1995. So the commerce has to take place. So in that sense, there was no law in this country which would ensure that anything which was shared in terms of email or sent electronically would be recognized. So that's why the IT Act was very important. So essentially when the IT Act was made, many people think that IT Act is basically to control cyber crime. Actually, the emphasis, the objective, if you see what the debate in the parliament was, it was basically to enable e-commerce. And so the act, major portion of the act, up to around section 65, actually talks about how to enable e-commerce and how to enable digital signatures. So this was the essence of it. It talks about, these are basic things, coordination. We did review this, it was, and 2008 it was reviewed. Let me go ahead. This is all other basic structure of this, that it extends certainly to the entire of India. Digital signatures. Anybody having idea about digital signatures? Because the IT Act actually is on digital signatures. What digital signature is, basically in layman terms, is that if you write a document, and then you put a digital signature into it, just like on a paper signature, what happens is that the signature is independent of the context, the content. So if you've written like three lines, the digital signature actually embodies those three lines together. I mean, there's a technology which is called, which reduces the three lines into certain number of characters. I mean, that technology is called hashing. So hashing makes it about 128 bits. I mean, the bits is again a computer term, and it is essentially the way the computer works. The computer works into zeros and ones. So basically, 128 bit means that there will be 128 either zeros or 128 either ones. So entire text, be it five pages or 10 pages, is converted into those 128 bits or 80 bits, depending on what kind of hashing algorithm you use. And that hash which is made is actually unique. Now there is this is a proven fact, that once these hash functions are generally one-way functions, in the sense that thoda bahut technology mein bata raha hu, but it is important to understand why digital signatures are kind of considered to be unique. And they're considered unique because unke andar content hota hai, that content is independent. This page, if you've written one word document and another word document, both will be different, and so their hashes will be different. So when you have that hash, then that hash is actually signed by mechanically encryption. Basically, you encrypt that signature, that particular hash. So that encryption is also done by a particular key which you own. So if you own that key and you encrypt it, so first the content is different, and then the key is also unique. So that is why, you know, you cannot tomorrow say that I did not sign it. So it's a concept of non-repudiation. You cannot repudiate. You cannot say that I never signed it. So that's why digital signatures are actually very important in digital commerce. Because if I send a contract, which I have, the entire five-page contract, which I have signed using my private key, I cannot say that this digital signature is not mine, because that that content was totally of that particular subject, and the signature was done using your private key. There's another concept that how will I know that this is your private key, this is your private signature. So there is a whole concept of which I think, this is what, that's a concept where the certifying authorities come into picture. So what happens is that my public keys, there are two keys which I have, the public key and the private key. So the private key encrypts and the public key can decrypt. So it is not that the same key is not used for decryption. Decryption, you understand? Anything which is encrypted, jumbled, if you have to reproduce that, you use a different key. I mean, that's the concept of public key infrastructure. Public key infrastructure basically means that there is an infrastructure which manages the public keys of all individuals. And those public keys are actually recognized by the certifying authority. Certifying authority basically certifies each public key using its own private key. So what is a digital certificate? It is actually my public key which is signed by a certifying authority, which is recognized, let us accept that. That is recognized by a certifying authority. And why is certifying authority required? Because there should not be a dispute. If I signed an instrument and my public key was there, so there should not be a dispute that this is not my public key. That public key is already recognized by a third party certifying agency. You are getting this concept? Please understand, if I and you are interacting and I signed it and sent it to you, there may be a dispute that you may say, I may say, look, I never signed it. But if there is a third party in between you and me, then this third party can say, look, you cannot go back and say that you never signed it because your public key was something which I really certified, and that is the public key which can decrypt whatever you have sent. So if you can decrypt that, that means you only signed it, because public key and private key pairs are unique. Public key and private key pairs are unique. So if I have a public key and I have a private key corresponding to that, no second person can have the same public key and private key. I mean, that's another axiom or another postulate of this. So the private key and the public key being unique, if I signed using my private key, I could decrypt only using my public key. And so that public key is recognized by a third party. So these brokering agencies, which are called certifying agencies, are very much important in digital commerce. Where is it being used? Today, if you are holding a director in any company, if you have to submit any returns to the Ministry of Company Affairs, you will have to sign your returns. Today, the balance sheets in India are actually digitally signed. So every director who is there on the board of a company, every private company has at least two directors. Public limited companies have 5+ directors. They all need to have these digital signatures. So whenever they sign a balance sheet, it is signed using a digital signature. And that's a digital signature which is recognized by the root authority through a registering. So I buy it from TCS. The TCS is recognized by the CCA. And that's why my signature is valid and it is legally tenable in India. So you understand that? So there's a trust relationship. So this entire cyber act was actually made for making sure that this trust relationship is recognizable, it is enforceable, and it is admissible. So all these things, you have to recognize them, you have to enforce them, and you will be able to be admissible in the court of law. So that's where the whole provisions of this act go. So there is a controller of certifying authority who sits at the Board of Delhi. And the certifying authorities are actually the smaller authorities, which are TCS, BSNL and others, okay? So the certifying authorities, as I've told you, they get the license from controller. So there's a root authority which gives the licenses to the smaller certifying agencies. Various types of, these are defined and stringent penalties. The computer crime was not defined, but they have talked about computer use and abuse. Why I am saying so is that computer crime, actually in the section 2 of the act, there was no such definition. And there was no such definition also because that the cyber law was actually meant for enabling digital commerce. And the crime was not looked into at that stage. But the crime came towards the later sections, and where they talked about how hacking would happen, how stealing of information can happen. So those kind of things are defined later on. One thing which is actually an issue here is that because it was digital commerce, because it was transactional oriented, because it was contract oriented, you will be reading contract and arbitrations later on in your coursework. You see, the contracts are normally enforced by civil courts, and there's a law of torts, and those things are different. They're not criminal in per se. So here, the entire act being focused on commerce, entire act being focused on transactions, on digital commerce, it was the emphasis that it will be more like a civil adjudication process. And that's why, you know, in any default of your digital signature, any dispute regarding your digital signature, any dispute regarding any digital communication, there is an adjudicating officer which has been named in the act. And that adjudicating officer normally is the secretary of IT of the state. Today in Maharashtra also, they have a secretary IT of the state. Now, this is the problem that you see. Most people think that cyber law is meant for catching criminals. So actually, cyber law, in essence, was never meant to catch criminals. It was actually made to enforce a digital commerce regime. And that's where the adjudicating officers come in. Otherwise, if you're talking about catching criminals, then the criminal law does not talk about adjudication. The criminal law talks about prosecution. So this is a difference. This is adjudicatory, whereas the criminal law is prosecution. There is provision of prosecution as well, which I will take you forward. Cyber regulatory, this is appellate tribunal. So you see, in the adjudication, if something was lost and if you did not really get your due, then you could go to an appellate tribunal. So the entire hierarchy, right from making a controller of certifying authorities, then there are certifying authorities, then there are individuals who are using these certifying authorities. If there was a dispute in any of use of any of these electronic commerce, then there will be an adjudicating officer. If the adjudicating officer you are not satisfied with, there will be an appellate authority to look at. So the entire law is actually oriented towards civil enforcement. That's the emphasis of the entire act. There is no such thing, and the courts cannot really. So the whole case of WhatsApp, if you have followed as WhatsApp, when WhatsApp merged with Facebook, the WhatsApp data was going to be taken over by Facebook. In India, it has fallen flat because we did not have a privacy law. So whatever we may say, and today the argument in Aadhaar. Now, even as young students, you should realize, why are we arguing in Aadhaar, and why the Supreme Court is actually, every day there are various observations which come of Supreme Court. What will happen, what will not happen? Why do you think laws are made? Now that's a basic question. Let me hear from you. Now the first year, guys, why do you think the laws are made?
Protection.
Where protection is one, which has somebody else? Why do you think laws are made? Anybody else?
Regulations to follow certain rules.
Follow certain rules, yeah, absolutely, yeah. Anybody else? So somebody said protection, somebody said rules, yeah?
Functioning of society.
Functioning of society, yeah.
Penalize the wrongdoer,
okay? So if we are debating today in Aadhaar or Facebook or WhatsApp, the debate goes on endlessly, and they are invoking sections of Article 21 of the Constitution, which is allowing people the right to livelihood, which they say includes privacy. But the whole moot point is that there is no law which I could have enforced. If there was a law, if person killed somebody, I don't have to debate in the court whether he will be prosecuted or not. This is nobody's business. When they know that there is a law, you will be under Section 302 of IPC you will be certainly criminally charged. But since there is no privacy law, today this has come to the courts. And my hunch will be, and you are, Professor Saab is sitting here, it will be very difficult for the court to really very clearly adjudicate yes or no. The court will ultimately come back, just like in the triple talaq case, will go back to the government saying that you need to define the privacy. And I think that would be the end of this. You have to define privacy, because the courts, if you understand law, the courts can only interpret law. If there is no law, yesterday there was a statement in the court, I mean today, you see, that's in the Scheduled Caste Scheduled Tribe Act case, the government has said that the Supreme Court cannot be making law and you cannot be diluting the provisions of the law, which is right, which is absolutely correct, because the executive, which is the parliament, they are the ones who can make the law. The courts can only enforce and at best interpret, certainly interpret, but cannot add on to the law. And that's where the problem is. Many judges want to add on to the law, and then the problem with the executive starts happening. And today, if the debate is going on for ages for the Aadhaar, and will happen in Facebook also, if somebody takes it to the court, it is only this, that we do not have a structured law which protects the privacy. And now let me give you the history. Privacy is actually something which is, I don't know, if you follow the privacy history, Britain had 1998 Data Protection Act. The Britain said Data Protection Act in 1998. US also has privacy issues, but unfortunately US is not so deeply into privacy at all. Why? Because they are still young as compared to Britain. And then go to Europe. The most stringent laws, if you have some time, please go through the Global Data Protection Regulation, GDPR, of Europe. GDPR of Europe is the most stringent, and that is why if you go and see the net, today if Zuckerberg could go and talk, and he appeared before the Congress in the US, in the Senate, but he is not ready to go to Europe. Why? Because in Europe the laws are very, very stringent. And just to give an example, the law of Europe is that if you violated the privacy of a citizen's data, you could be charged to an extent of, I may be corrected, but you can go through it. They say 4% of your turnover or 200,000 euros, whichever is maximum, it is not the minimum. So 4% of a global turnover is what they are going to charge you in case. So Europe is serious business, and all of these companies have been very seriously charged in Europe for this. So you see where we are. If you see the global map, India is actually not having a privacy law. That's why we are debating. Europe is not debating Facebook at all. Europe will lock them up and they will say this much money. And that's where Zuckerberg has a problem. WhatsApp was fined somewhere around 80 million euros. Microsoft for antitrust, again several hundred million euros in Europe. So Britain and US are still not so much so for privacy, and that's what they are trying to talk about. And if they don't want to do business in Europe, does not want to do business with India, it's basically of lack of privacy here. And they say any country which wants to interact with Europe and do business with Europe will have to follow the global data protection regulations, which are of Europe, which are as stringent as, in case you do anything wrong, you will be losing this money. So powers of police officers, police officers have been given powers in the IT Act to for search and seizure. So they can arrest you, and they can, certain offenses have been made cognizable. The cognizable means that police, without waiting for the court to order, can go into your house, search and arrest you without warrant. But obviously within 24 hours, they will have to produce you to the nearest court. So that's why there are these advisory committees which are there for... This is, they say that if you sign, it will be as far as a digital signature. Various types of communications are there. Electronic communications is, emails are now recognized. Contract, the contract is any agreement between two parties based on a promise and a consideration is a contract which will be accepted if it was sent by email. Electronic filing of documents, that is where all my balance sheets and everything which I file electronically cannot be challenged, and they can be produced as an evidence against me in case there was something wrong. And retention of documents in electronic form. They are saying that if I stored logs, most electronic forms are logs, then they will be, can be produced, and the evidence can be led based on that kind of those logs. Now for your information, for all of you who use internet, there's a rule for internet service providers to store all the activities of each person in their systems, and they are supposed to hand it over to the law enforcement agencies as and when they want. So well, whatever you may think about, but if the country wants, and if they want to really look at what you wrote, today the provisions are there, so they will be able to reach. The integrity means that, well, from honesty you develop it, you cannot change it. So whatever my document was, it cannot be changed. So when something cannot be changed, then that means the integrity of the document has been kept. So I sent ABC, it cannot be CAB is not keeping the integrity. The integrity is kept when ABC remains ABC, right? So that's where it says that any alteration in the document will be lacking integrity. And they are saying digital signatures were made, as I was trying to explain you, that the hash of that entire document was supposed to work as a and signed as a unique reference. So if anything in this hash was changed, then the document will not remain the same, and that's where this situation comes. Okay, so integrity.
Can you call it integrity original?
No, integrity actually is there are three terms: confidentiality, integrity, and authentication. These are technical terms which have been taken from. So integrity of a database, I mean, I will talk about technology, integrity of a database, integrity of an email means that nothing has changed. So original is coming close, but actually integrity is the technical term. I mean, if you are as a law graduate, you will have to, well, honesty also means the same, uniformity also means the same, but sometimes you have to make the technical difference between this is a stronger term and this is a term which is internationally accepted. Interception of any message transmitted in electronic form. So, you see, if something is encrypted and it has to be intercepted, the encryption will have to be reversed. Now that's something which the Act provides. The Act says that if you encrypted something and somebody received it, and if the government wanted it, then you will have to decrypt it, and you have to have means to decrypt it. It cannot be that I use my WhatsApp with encryption and I will not be able to decrypt it. So that's why some time back they wanted WhatsApp servers to be located in India. It happened with BlackBerry. BlackBerry was using the BlackBerry. It said that we will give you the keys. So all those things are related to the ITA. So these are the various acts which were modified actually using this banker's book evidence. So anything which was in digital form will be taken. Similarly, in Indian Bank Code, Evidence Act allowed digital evidence, and same so with the Reserve Bank of India. So these are the various acts which were also amended in this format. Okay. So now the section 43 is a very important section, which is talking about some bit of the basic essence of section 43, which also got amended later on in the 2008, is that it talks about unauthorized copying, extracting, downloading, introduction of virus, damage to computer, disruption, unauthorized access. Most of this was actually adjudicated upon till 2008. 2008, if anything of this happened, then there was an adjudicating officer, then there was an appeal, and then there was a high court. But there was no criminality involved for quite some time. So the section 43 in this manner was actually adjudicated upon. They defined what the problems were. But no, at no place it still talked about any computer crime. It didn't talk about computer crime, and that was the lacuna here. So this goes about if you do not allow access to an authorized person, assistance to any person to facilitate, charging the service availed. So this is what damages were there. When you talk about damages, you're talking about civil court. This is not criminal. Yeah. Any compensation not exceeding 1 crore. So who will give the compensation? The secretary IT, who is the adjudicating officer. Very good. Availed to a person. So most of this, actually, if you go back, is unauthorized copying. If you are students of law, unauthorized copying is actually taking out something without somebody's
consent.
So that's 379. If you are taking something without his knowledge and consent, it was 379. Extracting is the same. Downloading means the same. So the problem with the IT Act was, and is, that it still thinks that 379 is adjudicatable. Well, it is not. There is no damages in the IPC. The IPC talks about you being charged and penalty charged. Unauthorized access could at some point of time. Why? If I made illegal gain and it caused a loss to somebody else, then it should be 420. And 420 is illegal gain to illegal loss. And that is something which is adjudicated upon in IT Act, which is wrong. I think these are things which are still under a lot of debate. And this is something which has to be addressed. Introduction of virus is actually mischief. You have those sections of 425, I think whatever the sections of IPC are. So they are of mischief. Damage to computer systems, causing damage, disruption. All these actually amount to some wrongful gain and wrongful loss at some point of time. So they are not being addressed, and I think that's where tampering with computers. So, no, this comes to the penal sections. So one more thing about 43, which I'll go again later on, is that 43 also said that all companies which store data of a person would have to store that data in a manner that it is not disclosed, and they will build safeguards, ensure safeguards, so that a private citizen's data is not leaked. If at all there is something which can be enforced today in Aadhaar, is probably that section 43. The section 43 talks about that the companies who take your personal data will have to store it in a secure manner and will be safeguarded. Now the problem in this is that what safeguard will be is not defined. If you understand that, if yesterday Mr. Dwivedi, who is I think the counsel for the government of India in the Aadhaar authority, and earlier their chief counsel, if you read that statement, they talked about that we made 12 feet walls around. This statement came in the press that they have made 12 foot walls to protect. Now, while 12 foot walls I'm not disputing, but what I'm saying is the government of India today for the national critical infrastructure has not really come out with very clear guidelines as to what should be the safeguard that the NTPC should build, what should be the safeguard that the ONGC should build, and what should be the safeguard that the Bhabha Atomic Center should build. Now that has to come to some standard, and it cannot be left to reason, it cannot be left to any debate. So again, I'm coming back to the same thing. Since there is no structured Privacy Act, since there is no structured safeguarding of how the national critical infrastructure will be, these things are being debated today. Basic operating system, source document means it could be of an application as well. If you have built an application and that application was hacked, so that's where it will be. Hacking with a computer, if you enter into somebody's computer and cause wrongful loss or damage, then there's a 3 years. The punishment is 3 years. Now the point I'm making is 3 years. If you went to wrongful loss and wrongful gain, it was 7 years in 420. So IPC was much stronger. Well, this is slightly diluted. But this is punishable, this is cognizable, this is prosecutable by the police before the courts. And it also has to like fines. So it's actually, though it will be non-billable because it's 3 years, but still, you know, not really in the sense that what IPC defined was cheating, though this is all cheating itself. Why will I hack? If I hacked into the computer, I mean, suppose when the ransomware, you heard about ransomware? Anybody here? You have seen what is the ransomware? Yeah, not only Pakistan, India also. Many companies in India were attacked. So they asked for money. So this is a clear-cut extortion, that I will lock you up or else you pay me, right? 384 of IPC. Isn't that true? You will read extortion. I don't know IPC kab padhate hai, I don't know. Really. So you will read extortion. So extortion, this is extortion. So, and you know what happened in India in all these cases? I know of companies in Chandigarh whose entire computers were logged, and actually they paid money. I know companies in Dubai who paid money. In India, what happened? We haven't seen a case being lost. Nothing was lost. Even if they would have lost the case, they would have lost a case which was diluting the offense. So this is you as young students, when you go practice law, these are some of the lacunas, and I'm sure this law will evolve and the law will be amended more clearly in future to take care of these lacunas. So this lacuna exists. I mean, there is a wrongful loss, wrongful gain cannot be minimized. Extortion in computers today is a fact of life, and you cannot really forget about it. So criminal offences, this electronic forgery, if you changed somebody's and stole somebody's digital signature. Cheating, forgery using forged electronic records, publication of digital signatures, and companies. These are all things which are very clearly defined here. But this, before this was 66, which is not here. 66 said about you cannot publish anything which is defamatory, which is true even today, but under those clauses of Article 19 of the Constitution. So here they are talking about anything which is wrong should be this all can happen: configuration of computer networks, unauthorized access, misrepresentation and suppressing material facts, directions which are in breach of confidentiality and privacy. Though the privacy is mentioned, but the privacy is not defined. So the essence is that today it talks about anything you do wrong in the computers, you could probably be taken care of, but that is actually much lesser than what the normal basic penal code really does. Offences by companies are defined in Section 75. Network service providers not to be liable. So this is what the section is where the ISPs get away with. They say no person providing any service as a network service provider shall be liable for third party information. That is, if suppose Facebook has a server in US and it has some information, and I am an ISP in Mumbai, which is any of these networks, Airtel or whatever, they cannot be He can prove that, look, it was not mine, I never did this, this was somebody else who did it. So that's where they will have to do due diligence in this. So, but one thing which the network service provider cannot get away with is that if suppose I wanted some data about some X communicating with Y, then they will have to give me the data, because that's something which is there as per the rules. There is an internet service provider rules in India which provide for making and keeping, safekeeping of these logs. But this is the amendments. The amendments have come very good. One of the basic major things is the child pornography, which has been taken care of, though it was mentioned lascivious earlier, but here the child pornography is very clearly defined, and that's one of the major achievements here. Protected systems, now again the lacuna is that they are saying certain systems will be made protected. Now obviously Aadhaar systems will be made protected, but they have made rules what will be protection, but not very clear rules. The rules today still are very banal, meaning they are very general. They are not very specific as to what should be there. So today, again, there is a problem of how to and where to. Okay. Central government in consultation with private bodies prescribes security practices. Now this is again open. There is not something that they have yet done. Central government can intercept, monitor, which is there. But today, the capability of monitoring, capability of interception may not be so much so that they will be able to do this in real time. And real time, I mean that if suppose a message is going which is encrypted, at the same time they will be able to decrypt it. So this is probably the capabilities the India government doesn't have and will probably, is looking forward to having phishing, password, all this, child pornography. So this is a section 43A. Which has been amended. I talked about section 43, we talked about certain protection of information. So data protection has been now taken care of in section 43A in the amended part. Cyber terrorism has come into being. Cyber terrorism is, if you go through the net, the entire countries today, today the biggest problem that the world is facing is cyber warfare may break out. And how the cyber warfare works out, I will give you a small example. There's a small country in Eastern Russia called Estonia. And Estonia has the entire banking and everything which is totally interconnected. They are on computer networks. So there was a problem of certain groups, radical groups, because a particular statue of a person was removed on the way it should be. So the radical groups attacked Estonia and they brought down the entire network. Now what will happen is that if I was an Estonian citizen, I was carrying their credit card or a debit card, my transactions will not be settled. I will not be able to withdraw any money. So the entire country actually was brought to standstill for three days totally. Another example of cyber warfare, I do not know if you there is a huge problem between North Korea and South Korea, and today North Korea is being addressed by US. A few years back, there was a leak in the Pacific Ocean, which is an oil rig was, there was a huge oil leakage, and the US has imposed serious on British Petroleum, serious damages for spoiling their environment and the sea at that point of time. This has been actually discussed in the internet, and they say that North Korea, to cut the story short, the platform which was used for the rigging, which is on the high seas, was actually made by Samsung in some manner, and Samsung is South Korea. So North Korea actually hacked into the Samsung systems and got oil. This is actually a process control system in which pressures get built, and depending on the pressure, the lid of the oil gets opened. So they hacked into the system and made sure that the lid was open, and that's how the oil is spilled. So, but this was never proved. The biggest cyber warfare today happens, the biggest army that exists is the US, after that China, after that North Korea, Iran, and Russia. These are the 4 or 5 countries which have the biggest cyber armies today. The maximum amount of money being spent today is on cyber terrorism, and I think the countries are trying to make sure that they are ahead of the others. I mean, there are many, many things which you can talk about cyber terrorism, but just to tell you this, that cyber terrorism is a major concern, and that's why the amended act talked about cyber terrorism and has put it at the same level as a waging war against the nation. And that's, I think, 121 of the article, IPC. Okay. So that's where they can be taken and hanged for doing this. Invasion of privacy is still not dealt with, which I said is a major crime. WhatsApp cannot be really hanged here. Facebook cannot be hanged. We can only debate in the court, and the court cannot really enact a law. The court cannot put punishments. Maximum, I do not know if there is some tort which they can probably prove, could be in the civil court, but that's not something which will suffice what people are losing. So that's where the problem is. So let me now try to conclude this and give you some more insights into this. First and foremost, the crime was not defined when it was started. It was a digital e-commerce platform which was being enabled using the IT Act. So there was nothing which defined crime, and this was the year 2000. They have amended it in 2008, put some more restrictions, put some more conditions, and have defined certain new things. So digital signatures was the major emphasis. Hacking is treated as very briefly and perfectly, which is true. Unauthorized access is very broad definition. Reasonable storage and access, when they say 43, you have to make reasonable storage so that the citizen's data is not lost, is actually not very clearly defined. They really have no idea as to how to make these laws. So in essence, if today we are debating what is Aadhaar violating the privacy, you could probably appreciate, which I am saying so, that you do not debate whether there was a theft, whether there was cheating. Why? Because they are coded, which define what is privacy. So that's why the Supreme Court has to agitate. But the problem is that many of us who look at Supreme Court today should know that Supreme Court also cannot make law. The law has to be made. So the Supreme Court can only work when there is a law. And when there is no law, then the arguments will go on endless. And there is no way that you can probably. So unless until we have the Data Protection Act, and we talk about reasonable storage, we will remain where we are. So the Cyber Act is something which is still in making. We are only about 17 years since we made it. I think there will be many, many more years. If US is still looking at what privacy should be, and they have defined privacy, they are 200 plus years at independence. We are very, very young. Their Computer Use and Abuse Act was made in 1985. We made it in 2000. The Data Protection Act, forget about the privacy part, but the data protection in Britain was 1998. And EU, which is the European Union, is far, far ahead in terms of privacy. And we still have a lot of catching up to do. Well, thank you for listening. And if you have any queries, we can ask you.
तो आपको याद होगा 2012 में असीम त्रिवेदी ही इज अ कार्टूनिस्ट अन्ना हजारे के मूवमेंट में एंटी करप्शन मूवमेंट में उन्होंने एक कार्टून पब्लिश किया था अपने वेबसाइट में तो ये एक साइबर क्राइम माना जाएगा क्योंकि वेबसाइट में उसने पब्लिश किया तो सेडिशन उसके ऊपर कैसे लग गया सेडिशन में से तो आईपीसी और बहुत बड़ी धारा होगी
Well, they were saying so, but in my opinion, the case, court have decided against sedition. Sedition charges have been dropped. In my opinion, recently, so sedition charges have been dropped against that particular journalist, if I'm not wrong. Actually, it could not have been said so. Palghar case, maybe they construed ki nahi, aisa hum nahi dekh sakte, but court have went totally against it. So there is a protection. So why? But there is a law the court can interpret. But if there is no law, what the court will interpret? So sedition, there is a law. This is obviously sedition is defined under section 121. So that the court could have interpreted. But aaj ki tarikh mein Aadhaar ke baare mein the court is actually debating what to do, where to do, where to go. So that's the whole issue.
Isme aise cases mein jab sedition laga diya ya aise lagate dharaein laga deti hai police station mein laga di jati hai. तो जो भी जिसमें पार्टी है जो भी अक्यूज्ड बनाया जाता है अक्यूज्ड है नहीं बना दिया जाता है वो तो परेशान हो जाएगा. तो जो ऑफिसर ऑन ड्यूटीज होते हैं तो उनके ऊपर कार्रवाई क्यों नहीं होती, क्योंकि जो उनको नुकसान होना अक्यूज में तो हो जाता है.
अब ये तो ऐसा है कि एक्चुअली क्रिमिनल लॉ में इसका प्रोविजन है कि आपने जो गलत धारा लगाई तो सीआरपीसी के हिसाब से आप उसको प्रोसिक्यूट कर सकते हैं, लेकिन उसके बारे में जागृत सिटीजन्स भी होने चाहिए जिनको आगे करना चाहिए कि भाई हाँ देर इज अ वेरी क्लियर प्रोविजन दैट इफ समबडी लॉजेस अ फॉल्स कंप्लेंट एंड प्रोसिक्यूट्स फॉल्सली ही कैन बी चार्ज्ड इक्वली फॉर दैट पर्टिकुलर क्राइम. हाँ मैनेजर प्रोसिक्यूशन वेरी क्लियरली डिफाइंड. सो
सेकंड क्वेश्चन इज जैसे फेसबुक की बात हम कर रहे हैं कि डेटा चोरी हो गई और जगह बस तो वहाँ पे कांग्रेस में उन्होंने अपना स्टेटमेंट दिया. अब यहाँ पे बोल रहे हैं हम उनको बुलाएंगे. खैर जब ये फेसबुक हम रिस्ट्रिक्ट अपने कंट्री तक कैसे कर सकते हैं, वो तो यूनिवर्सल है सब तरफ, किधर पोस्ट किया सब तरफ चला गया.
नहीं रिस्ट्रिक्ट करने के लिए तो जगह आप रिस्ट्रिक्ट करना चाहें पहले तो आप क्यों करना चाहेंगे ये एक बात है. और जगह आप रिस्ट्रिक्ट करना चाहें तो रिस्ट्रिक्ट करना तो 100% है ना. किधर फेसबुक नहीं चलता चाइना में, चाइना डजंट नो फेसबुक. चाइना में आप गूगल नहीं चला सकते. तो इतनी बड़ी कंट्री है लेकिन उनका अपना उनका वो है कि और वहाँ पर आप माइक्रोसॉफ्ट में जाते हैं या लाइसेंस भरते हैं आप हर बार विंडोज 2000 का विंडोज 10 का. वहाँ लाइसेंस वाइसेंस कुछ नहीं है. वो कहते हैं कि आप फ्री हमारे आप पूरा कोड लेके आइए अदरवाइज यू कैन नॉट कम. सो करने के लिए आप सऊदी अरेबिया में चले जाइए तो आपको स्काइप नहीं चलता है. दुबई में आप स्काइप से बात नहीं कर सकते, व्हाट्सएप पर बात नहीं कर सकते. कंट्रीज कुछ करना है तो करते हैं, मतलब यू कैन नॉट डू इट.
Sir, as per Maharashtra Stamp Duty Act, if stamp duty is not paid for a contract, it cannot be accepted as evidence in the court of law. So how is electronic contract will be managed in such situations?
No, you have to digitally produce the evidence that you have paid the stamp duty. Obviously, without paying stamp duty, that contract will not be legally tenable. So you have to digitally prove or digitally show that yes, this is a receipt, this is what you proved, I mean this is what you paid. Aajkal to franking, digital franking hoti hai. Frank karaiye digital document, usko aap email se bhej dijiye. Email se kya aajkal scan documents jaate hain, jagar scan to kya tha, that is acceptable.
So digital document can be franked digitally use?
Haan, digitally franking to aajkal India, Bombay mein hoti hai. Aap jaake kitne paise kabhi digitally frank kara liye, stamp lagta hai. Okay. Anything else?
Sir, जो recently आया था कि HDFC banks, ICICI bank and some places state banks के data चोरी हो रहे हैं. तो अगर हम बोलेंगे हमारे पास ऐसा कोई system नहीं है तो उसके लिए क्या कर सकते हैं? ये तो purely personal information है ना हमारी. आप हमारा bank data चोरी कर रहे हो वो भी online.
तो वही तो प्रॉब्लम है. एक्चुअली आज जो अगर हम न्यूज़पेपर आइटम पढ़ते हैं और लोगों के ब्लॉग्स में पढ़ते हैं कि हमारा डेटा क्या हो रहा है, तो इंडिया में प्राइवेसी के ऊपर कोई एक्ट ही नहीं. आज की तारीख में जो इंडिया में सबसे बड़ा कंसर्न है वो है अपना प्राइवेट डेटा हार्वेस्टिंग. और जो मैं किसी कंपनी का नाम लूँगा तो कोई मैं पार्टिसन नहीं हूँ, लेकिन जितनी भी ये बड़ी बड़ी कंपनियाँ जो आपको फ्री में सर्विसेज दे रही हैं वो फ्री में नहीं दे रही है, वो आपका डेटा लेकर उस डेटा को बेच रही है. अब इंडिया में उस डेटा को यूज़ किया जा रहा है तो जैसे इंडिया का कंज्यूमर बिहेवियर को गेस करने के लिए, गेज करने के लिए ये आपके पर्सनल ट्रांजैक्शन बहुत जरूरी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है. तो आज जो भी आप फ़ोन में ट्रांजेक्ट कर रहे हैं, बात कर रहे हैं, वो सारा डेटा जो है वो लेके बाहर के कंपनीज को देकर वो कैम्ब्रिज एनालिटिका का तो अभी सिर्फ फेसबुक के बारे में बात आई है, लेकिन कैम्ब्रिज एनालिटिका हैज नेवर सेड कि दे आर ओनली लुकिंग एट फेसबुक. दे माइट बी लुकिंग एट सो मच अदर डेटा विच कुड बी योर फोन डेटा विच कुड बी योर वॉइस डेटा. आज की तारीख में वी हैव नो प्राइवेसी. आप जो कर एग्रीमेंट पढ़ के देखें जो कर किसी भी एयरटेल का तो उसमें हर जगह डिस्क्लेमर यही है कि वी विल नॉट होल्ड अस रिस्पॉन्सिबल. सो एक कंट्री में प्राइवेसी लॉ होना बहुत जरूरी है. प्राइवेसी लॉ न लाने का कारण भी मतलब आज की तारीख में दिस बिल हैज बीन देयर इन द पार्लियामेंट हैज नेवर बीन पास्ड बिकॉज देर आर वेरियस प्राइवेट प्लेयर्स who will lose a huge amount of money and who will lose actually their entire business platform. The business platform is this only, to provide free services, collect data, harvest data, give it to whichever country which wants it, to sell the data. But data selling is a very major thing today. So if I bring the India brings privacy law, some of these major players will be out of business. Otherwise, free kaise service de rahe hain? Aap khud sochiye, koi bhi cheez free kaise aapko di ja rahi hai? Koi na koi cheez to aapse उसको एक्सपेक्टेशन है ही है. सो इंडिया में प्राइवेसी एक्ट होना जरूरी है. ये साइबर लॉ के साथ साथ प्राइवेसी एक्ट भी लाना चाहिए था. बट एज आई सेड लॉट ऑफ बिगर प्लेयर्स हैव मेजर इंटरेस्ट हियर एंड बिकॉज ऑफ विच वी आर नॉट एबल टू गेट दी प्राइवेसी लॉज इन प्लेस. आप जो अगर लॉ के स्टूडेंट हैं आप जरूर GDPR पढ़िए, ग्लोबल डेटा प्रोटेक्शन रेगुलेशन ऑफ यूरोप. यू विल अंडरस्टैंड how privacy is being defined and how people are so scared going and entering Europe and leaking out information because their damages and everything is they are talking about turnover which is like aap jo kar aaj Tata jo kar $100 billion hai to kya 4% tumhara lagega to $4 billion aapko fine lagega to hoga kaam nahi hoga. So this is what the whole thing is. Okay, anybody else? Okay. Thank you.
Gratitude towards Shri Sanjay Pandey sir for sparing his precious time and enlightening us on cyber laws. And I would also like to thank our principal Dr. A.K. Singh sir for arranging this program. I would also like to thank our teachers and non-teaching staff for their constant support and cooperation. Last but not the least, I would like to thank our audience for being patient listeners throughout the session.